We talk about how many of the outputs from large language models indicate that these models hallucinate. But what does hallucination mean? From this paper in 2022, it indicates that hallucination refers to when the generated content is nonsensical or unfaithful to the provided source content. It means that the output can sound completely natural and fluent, and it also means that the output can sound really confident even when it's wrong. There are two types of hallucination, intrinsic and extrinsic. Based on individuals, we may all have different tolerance levels based on how faithful or how factual we expect these outputs to be. And we'll talk in just a second about what faithful actually means in this context. Intrinsic refers to when the output directly contradicts the source. If I give a source text that indicates the first Ebola vaccine was approved by the FDA in 2019, but a summary output indicates that the first Ebola vaccine was approved in 2021. So this is a very clear case of contradiction, and it means that the output is not faithful to the source text over here. And it also means that this output is completely not factual as well. On the other hand, for extrinsic hallucination, it refers to when we cannot verify the output from the source, but the model itself might not be wrong. For example, if I were to say Alice won first prize in fencing last week, and then the model tells me that Alice won first prize in fencing for the first time last week and she was ecstatic. It's probably true that Alice did that for the first time and she was really excited that she got it, but we cannot verify that from the source. It means that we cannot really say that the output is factual or faithful towards the source. So what leads to hallucination? The first component, probably without any surprises, is the data. So how we collect data matters a lot in terms of how the model performs. And we talked about in the earlier segment that when we have big data, it's really hard to do audits well or do any audits at all. Same goes to the data collection process. We may gather any text that we have without any factual verification. We also do not filter out exact duplicates most of the time. For example, if you were to ingest the same Reddit thread twice, that counts as a duplicate. And duplicates can bias the model. If we have many of the same Reddit threads show up in the data, then it means that it's more likely for the model to output responses from those Reddit threads. But the other problem regarding the data is actually just regarding how open-ended these generative tasks are. For example, in a chat application, we will probably want the chatbot to be more engaging, and therefore it means that we would expect more diverse responses. If we were to ask the chatbot about the same thing many times, but the chatbot will always repeat the same things, it will probably be a chatbot that we won't use for very long. So we want the chatbot or some applications to have more diversity to improve engagement, but this type of diversity can also correlate with bad hallucination, especially when we need factual and reliable output. When we ask a chatbot about medical literature, our tolerance level for anything that is non-factual will be quite low compared to when we ask something about how to make a perfect salad. But this open-ended nature of generative tasks is just a really hard to avoid problem, and it's something that we'll have to deal with as a user of LLM applications. The second prong that leads to hallucination is the model. The first reason we need a model itself is the imperfect encoder learning. It means that encoder learns wrong correlations between parts of training data. The second reason can happen at decoding time, which means that when the model is trying to generate text output, the decoder actually attends the wrong part of the input source. But there are also decoder design that is by design encouraging randomness and also unexpectedness. For example, top K sampling. So for those type of decoders, rather than picking the most likely token, it would select any one of the out of the four candidates over here that you see on the slide to generate the next token. The third reason is exposure bias. So very technically speaking, this means that there is a discrepancy in decoding between the training and also inference time. But plainly speaking, it means that model tends to generate output based on its own historically generated token. So it also means that the model can veer off a topic. When you start off asking about a dishwasher, maybe the model itself would then start generating content about the dryer. The fourth reason has to do with parametric knowledge bias. As a summary, it means that the model will stick to what it knows. So all models tend to generate output based on what it has memorized rather than the provided input. Evaluating hallucination is tricky and imperfect. As I mentioned before, different individuals can have different expectations about how the models actually behave, and we can also have very different decision criteria to determine whether a certain content is toxic or whether a certain content is classified as misinformation. There are two categories of metrics here that we can rely on to assist with evaluating hallucination. The first category is statistical metrics. Blue Roach Meteor have been around for some time in NLP, and when using this metrics, we see that approximately 25% of summaries contain hallucination, which means it contains unsupported information. The second metric over here is called parent, which measures the hallucination using both source and also output text. It means that it's actually using n-grams behind the scene to capture what is in the source versus the target, and then it calculates the F1 score. The third type of metric is called BVSS, which stands for Bag of Vectors Sentence Similarity. It measures whether the translation output has the same amount of information as the translation reference. The second category is model-based metrics. It means that we're leveraging another model to help us evaluate hallucination. But this category of metrics also means that any of the errors from these models that we're leveraging also get propagated throughout as well. So the first type of model that we can leverage is information extraction. And this is especially useful for any name entity recognition use cases. We are trying to extract knowledge. So we can use this to compare with a language model output. The second metric over here is question answering based. Means that we can measure the faithfulness by measuring the similarity among the different answers to the same question. The third metric over here is faithfulness. It asks the question, does the output actually contain any unsupported information? The last one over here is language model based, which means that we're using a language model to help us calculate if there is a ratio of hallucinated tokens to the total number of target tokens. So as you can see over here, there are a variety of metrics to help us evaluate hallucination, but none of them is perfect. In the next segment, we'll talk about mitigation strategies.